My name is Elaine Haney, and I am the CEO and President of Tributes.com, and I'm so pleased that you have all chosen to join us this evening and to take advantage of the opportunity to listen and learn from our grief expert, Russell Friedman. Russell Friedman and John James, the authors of the Grief Recovery Handbook, have been important partners of Tributes.com for several years, providing our users with a wealth of information and guidance. Their depth of caring and understanding as it pertains to helping people navigate grief is evident in all of their work, and I so much appreciate having them on our team and the relationship we've built. We are warmed by all of the great questions we received for this evening's session. Unfortunately, we won't be able to get to them all, so if your question or one like it is not answered or addressed in the webinar, you can ask a question directly of Russell on Tributes.com in the Grief Recovery Center. Just click on the Ask a Question button and fill in the form, and Russell always answers questions personally within a day or two. He's wonderful like that and making sure he connects with people who submit questions through that forum. We'd also be happy to have you submit questions, comments, and suggestions for future webinars by emailing to the webinar questions at tributes.com email address. We will be conducting quarterly webinars through the first quarter of next year. Our schedule includes the following planned sessions. In June, grieving the loss of a parent. In September, grieving the loss of a child. In early December, dealing with grief during the holidays. And in the first quarter of next year, grieving loss associated with suicide. Again, thank you all for being here with us tonight. I hope you find the session helpful and informative. And with that, I would like to introduce Russell Friedman.
Thank you, Elaine, and welcome, everybody. I know an awful lot of you know of Tributes.com because that's how you heard about this event. But we also have some people that have come into our portal from www.griefrecoverymethod.com. So I very much want to commend you all to please go look at Tributes.com. Go to that website. You can go to our area of it. But it's something of value for anything that's going around the country, you know, perhaps packing your hometown and things you might need or want to know, the things that have happened to people that have been important in your life. And I also want to thank Elaine and the entire Tributes.com staff. Over the last couple of years that we've been partnered with them, I frankly have never found a better partnership. It's just ideal. So thank you, Elaine, and everyone else. Now, to get going, this is the third of the webinars we've done, and we're not going to go over some of the same ground that we've done the other times, but I want to do a little bit to set you up to be able to understand the answers we're going to give to the questions we've gotten. But in the meantime, the other two webinars, the prior ones, are available at Tribute.com. You can go back after today at any point and listen to the earlier ones because it may give reference to some of the things we're talking about. Now, with that said, I'm going to do a little preamble of identifying the six major myths that affect almost all of us. In fact, having been doing this for more than 26 years, it's my observation that this is everyone in the world, because we have people come from every country on this globe, from every community, every religion, every culture, every original language, and we find that these myths are really affecting. And before I get to them, let me get to the slide on the screen. And that says that every relationship that has ever happened on planet Earth is unique. There are no exceptions. So even if someone you know has had a parallel experience to one you had in who died, if they had a spouse died of a certain age, in a certain place, a certain time, a certain way, they still don't know how you feel, because every relationship is unique, and we each have our own unique relationship to our own feelings, to our own grief, to what we know and believe. So what sets up part of that uniqueness for all of us are the six major myths that we have identified over the, John started 35 years ago identifying them to help himself deal with the death of a baby son, and over time we've learned that these myths are the limiters for everybody, regardless of the type of loss they've experienced. So, to get us going, the first major myth we identify is one that most of us get when we're 3, 4, or 5 years old, when something sad has happened and we come back and tell our parents who we trust and with tears in our eyes. And we say they had a bad day at preschool and say the other little kids were mean to me, at which point our parents accidentally make a huge error and they say something like, quote, "Don't feel bad, honey. Here, have a cookie. You'll feel better." Now, if you feel sad and you're crying and someone gives you a cookie, does the cookie make you feel better or does it make it you feel different? And the obvious answer is different. It distracts you, puts a little sugar in your body. It moves you away from the topic that you brought up, even as a little kid, that you don't feel good, and suggests that therefore you shouldn't feel the way you feel. And it kind of pushes away the topic. Now, this keeps repeating over and over to the point that in our society, several years ago, the Centers for Disease Control made a report that there were over 250,000 obesity-related deaths in America every year. And it's pretty easy to draw a correlation between "don't feel bad, here, have a cookie," which is basically saying consume a substance to deal with your feelings. Okay, so we eat food and then later it may shift to alcohol or narcotic drugs in an attempt to push feelings away. And yet, if someone important to you dies, aren't you entitled to feel sad or feel bad, to feel depressed? Not in the clinical sense, but just in the sense of a lowered state of feeling. Aren't you entitled to have some fear about what your life holds forward for you after that loss? And yet the first instruction we get is don't feel bad. And we're going, well, if that's the truth, then if something happy happens, should we not feel good? And I know that sounds stupid because it is. You know, in order to be a human, you must have the capacity for joy and sadness, and you must be able to express both sides of that coin. So the real key here is to undo the myth that feeling bad is bad. Feeling bad is what makes us human. Feeling bad is what gives us an honest reaction to things that don't feel bad. So we all, on all sides of the coin, whether we are the griever ourselves or we're someone around a griever, we have to stop telling them that they shouldn't feel bad. And those of you who have had a spouse die, whether it was a 50, 60, 70-year marriage or 20 or 30 or any number, all of you have heard, "don't feel bad, he's in a better place," or "don't feel bad, he's not suffering," if there had been a long-term illness. And yet maybe it's true that the person is in a better place. We certainly hope so if that's a probability. But what we have learned in 35 years at the Grief Recovery Institute is that the griever isn't in a better place, how devastated, how heartbroken they are. So telling someone not to feel bad when it's normal, natural, healthy, logical to feel bad or feel sad puts them in conflict with their own nature, because it's our nature to feel what our truthful reaction to things and to communicate it. But if we take it away starting in childhood, it becomes a lifelong habit to not say how we feel. So I want everybody to really think about this over today, over the next few days and weeks, and revisit your own knowledge base of what you learned, whether you know how you learned it or not, and try to take that out of the equation. And just think, would I tell someone who's happy not to feel good? Therefore, why would I tell someone who's sad not to feel sad? It doesn't make sense. Now, the second myth is called replace the loss. And this is another one we tend to learn very early in life. For example, when John James, my partner, my friend, my co-author at the Grief Recovery Institute, when he was a little boy, his favorite entity in the whole world was his dog, Peggy. Peggy was just everything to him, as it often is with a child. You know, growing up and whatever difficulties he was having, the dog was the constant, the loving place, the unconditional place. And Peggy died. John was about 7. And his parents got him and said, "John, don't feel bad." There's that line again. "Don't feel bad. On Saturday, we'll get you a new dog." And Saturday, they did go get John a new dog. But as John remembers how he felt way back in the day, he didn't want a new dog. What he wanted, like any kid would, is he wanted Peggy back, but he couldn't get her. And he didn't feel like he wanted to put his heart out to the new dog because he was afraid it would get hurt again. He actually gave that dog to his baby younger brother because he didn't want to get hurt. He wasn't ready to make a new relationship with a different dog. So, but replace the loss was taught to him in no uncertain terms. Several years later, when he was a senior in high school, and his girlfriend and he broke up, and he was just so terribly sad. At one point, his mother, seeing his sadness after a few days, said, John, don't feel bad. There are plenty of fish in the sea, which was the first time John knew he had been dating a fish. Now, I don't mean to be humorous here. I don't mean to make light or make jokes of a serious situation, whether it's a breakup or a death or any other loss. I just want to lighten it a little bit so we can hear how absurd the idea is that if you break up with your spouse or if your spouse dies, that you shouldn't feel bad. You should just go get another one. And because the message from John's mother was just go get another girlfriend. And I know that almost everybody listening, if you have had a spouse die, even regardless of your age, at some level there's an implication or an indication that you not only shouldn't feel bad, that you should start thinking about dating. And we will talk about that later. I think one of our questions tonight will relate to that. So the third myth we want to get to after don't feel bad and replace the loss is a really troublesome one. Let me introduce it by kind of asking a question, although you can't answer me out loud. If I suggest to you that grieving people tend to isolate, would you be nodding your head right now, say either you know that or you felt that or you've heard that? Probably most everybody knows that grieving people tend to isolate. What most people don't know is that it is not a normal and natural reaction to loss. The normal and natural reaction to loss is to tell someone you know, someone you trust, someone you love, how you feel. In the same exact way as if you get a raise at work or you get a bonus or you get something wonderful happen, the very first thing you want to do is kick up your heels and pick up the phone and call someone and say, guess what? I got something really good happen to me. Well, in nature, it is equally natural to want to tell someone when something important in the negative happens to you, painful, sad, or negative. So grieving alone is also something, and I want you all to play along. I'm going to say a sentence, and I'm going to leave the last word out. And I want you all to think about this and just come to yourself. Just say the word I left out, because you're all going to know it. Ready? Laugh, and the whole world laughs with you. Cry, and you cry. Now, you all know the word, and if you don't, it'll come right in. Alone. Laugh and the whole world laughs with you, cry and you cry alone. It's one of the reasons that we've all been influenced to believe that we shouldn't cry, that we shouldn't feel sad, and if we do, we shouldn't show it to anyone. How many of you out there, heard things like don't burden others with your feelings, which is another reason we isolate. Or people say, oh, leave him or her alone, he needs some space or she needs some space. So we are not only feel isolated by what we learn, but the people around us having learned similar things isolate us, they avoid us. When you go to our website, www.griefrecoverymethod.com. I want you to look for an article we wrote called Am I Paranoid or Are People Really Avoiding Me? And it makes it really very difficult to do that. Now, the next myth is maybe the most pernicious at all, and that is that grief just takes time or time heals all wounds. And I'm just going to simply say about this one is that time can't fix your broken heart any more than time could put air in a flat tire. Of the thousands of emails and letters we get through tributes and other sources from grievers asking questions, they keep saying, someone died 6 months ago or a year ago. When will I feel better? And we have to answer that recovery or feeling better or completion is not a product of time. It is a product of actions taken within time. And later in the show, as we answer questions, we'll get to a little bit of an idea to you of what those actions might be. The fifth myth is the myth that, and you've all heard it, following a loss, you have to be strong or you have to be strong for others. So we tend to think that's a really strange instruction, and so we give you a different choice. You can be strong or you can be human. Pick one. typically people in trying to be strong will hide their feelings. So we're right back to the first myth of don't feel bad, and that's what being strong looks like, and it isn't an honest communication. And the last of the six myths is the myth that says you got to keep busy, and everyone has heard that following major losses, and we've seen people almost work themselves into an early grave just doing that, and all it does is distract them. It doesn't fix their broken heart. So that's it for the myths. Now we're ready to move forward here. And here's a big question. When is it time to begin to recover? Again, this is a question we get all the time. And what I want to do is point you to page 16 and 17 of the Grief Recovery Handbook, where there's a little essay on that question. And one of the questions it asks in the essay is that if you fell down and tore your leg open and the blood was gushing out, would you immediately seek medical attention? And the obvious answer is yes, you would. And the second question is, if circumstances and events conspire to break your heart, should you immediately seek emotional attention or bleed to death emotionally? Pick one. So as you can see, our point of view is that the sooner the better, the time to begin to recover, the time to move from grieving to recovery. There is a time space there as we adapt to the loss, but moving towards recovery is very important because memory alters and fades within time. So it's actually the closer to the death or other loss we are when we start doing recovery work, the more accurate and truthful our memories of that relationship and the things that were part of it, good, bad, and sometimes ugly. And so that's when we start to recover. Now, one of the benefits of grief recovery and moving out of grief where people stay stuck or paralyzed is that you can keep the fond memories, but you can get rid of the pain. It is just heartbreaking if all you have left after a long-term relationship with someone you love, if you have pain be the byproduct of love, it doesn't even make sense. It's heartbreaking on top of the heartbreak. Again, I refer you to our website, griefrecoverymethod.com, to an article we wrote called Legacy of Love or Monument to Misery, and it will help you kind of reassess things so that rather than living in pain as a way of almost proving you love someone, we'd rather have you live with the ability to access fond memories, to talk about them without them turning painful. And what's one of the byproducts of effective grief recovery is keeping fond memories, keeping the warmth and fuzzy, and losing the pain. Now, the next tab here says how to deal with the things friends and family say. And one of the things you might begin to realize already, when I just kind of quickly went through those six myths, a lot of the things people say, that people who love you, friends and family love you, but they don't know what to say and they say wrong things, and they will constantly say, well, don't feel bad, and they will say that time heals, and you're going to go, well, it's been a year and it's been 9 months and I don't feel better yet. It's very difficult to educate your friends and family when you are the griever. It's really hard to turn to them, go out of who you are and try to teach them something when you're flailing away just trying to keep your life moving at all after a major loss, especially the death of a spouse. What you might do is when you have learned to access the Grief Recovery Handbook and When Children Grieve and our other books, you can also refer them there rather than trying to help them understand directly and try to explain all this. Send them to the book, send them to our website. There are many of our articles will help them understand that. Now, the other thing, some people will say things that you might even find offensive. They're not because they're intentionally that. People just don't know. And if someone offers up something and it doesn't feel good, just to get yourself out of the way, just say thank you, I appreciate your concern, and step away from a conversation rather than getting in a battle. The last thing you want to do is be distracted so you're arguing with someone about grief rather than dealing with what you have to deal with internally and externally. This is a big big, big issue, especially in long-term relationships where we all gather stuff. Everybody's spring cleaning has its place. But after someone's died, the stuff that has accumulated, the things, the possessions that are part of our relationships, things that we acquired together, things that have huge meaning and emotional value to us, are there. And some people really, it's perfectly okay to feel attached to things. Now, it's also, most people realize they don't want to keep everything. So in the back of the Grief Recovery Handbook, it's an interesting little plan. It's called the pile plan, and it's a little way of defining what you want to keep for sure, things that you're sure you don't want or need anymore, and a third pile of things that you're not sure about, and you'll keep them and go through them again. Read it in the book. It's in detail. And then one of the most important things, though, it says, is to make sure when you do go through the possessions, because it can be a very emotional thing to do, to make sure someone you trust is with you there. Because if you have feelings, you don't want to do them alone. You don't want to isolate. You want to be able to talk about some of the memories that attach to some of the items. But read it in the book. It'll be very, very helpful for you. When can I start dating? Well, that's a great question, but it's an unanswerable one because it relates to the issue of does time heal or not? And the real answer to this is so unique that I could never tell anyone. You have to make your own decision. But if you do the actions of grief recovery, then you will start to know when you are really ready. We wrote an article recently where the title of which was, just because you're lonely doesn't mean you're ready to start dating. I recommend that article because it helps put in perspective that we need to really feel emotionally complete, which is a piece of language you may not understand, that you will when you've done grief recovery, so that you can really be available to want to be with someone, to be able to share at any level, you know, beginning, middle, or even a long-term relationship. So the act of dating really is not a reaction to loneliness. It's a reaction to, I feel complete and now I want to share my life with someone. And again, the timing of it is unique and individual. Now we're really at the topic, and we've got a decent amount of time between now and the end of the session. So let's get that first question up there and let's get going. This is from Sue. After decades of marriage, how does one rebuild a life, especially if one has never had experience living all alone? When so much of life has been devoted to sustaining a good marriage and caring for family, now there seems to be no purpose. Children have grown and moved away and have their own lives. I'm left alone now with no one to share my life with, to talk to care for, to correct my use of prepositions. And so let's at least have a little humor within this, you know, because I tend to, even as a writer, how often there's a preposition at the end of my sentence and I have to go back and rewrite it. So a little humor here. First of all, if I was anywhere near you, I probably wouldn't talk first. I'd offer a hug just to honor your question and the obvious amount of feelings in it, the emotions attached to it. Having been so many years of doing all the things you mentioned in your note and having a purpose in there and now feeling as if there is none. Now, we get this call all the time where the children and grandchildren live in a different state and also, Sue, because I'm not a puppy myself anymore, as we get older, our world shrinks. Some people, you know, as you know, some of our contemporaries die and our world gets smaller. One of the keys here, as it is earlier in life, is we have to rebuild and reestablish things that we can do, age-appropriate things that and new relationships. So hobbies, volunteering is incredible. I started a grief recovery 26 years ago as a volunteer. And has become, you know, a life's work for me. So, and my spouse started her second career as a volunteer. So there are various things to be done there. And getting involved with various organizations where there are people. One of the keys to your note is not having people to share with. Now, I acknowledge to you that it's different than having a mate to share with, and you may or may not want one. That's not our purpose in answering that way. But you need to feel fulfilled by doing things. The people who do things feel better about themselves and their life, and then there is a purpose. So we suggest you find the interests in your life and move towards them, and you will find purpose in the doing. From Craig, since my wife's death 2 months ago, I feel like an empty shell, as if what was me died when she died. I cannot imagine ever regaining a sense of self, having a life with purpose, or that there will be any future happiness without her. How do I regain myself? Thanks, Craig. Great question. And boy, this is one I'm sure an awful lot of people can relate to. In the glory of love, there is that sense of becoming kind of one. Although we're two individuals, we put ourselves together, we make a beautiful new couple, a family, and all of those things. When that relationship ends due to death, there is an absolute feeling that a piece of you is gone. The empty shell image is an incredibly powerful image. And again, what you have to do is to rebuild from within the sense of value so that you have a possibility of moving forward. And now, to be happy without her is not an insult to her or her memory. And that's one of the traps. People are afraid to be joyful or happy, to rebuild a life of any kind, because somehow it would dishonor. We don't believe that's true, but we know a lot of people feel that way. So what you got to do is take the actions of grief recovery, which are outlined in the Grief Recovery Handbook, and will help you discover and complete everything that's unfinished. And of course, I'm sure there are some unrealized hopes, dreams, and expectations about the future, and it will help you get complete so that you can move forward even without her. And we're not saying it's easy, but we're saying you need to do it. There's too much about your relationship with her that you have to share with us, the rest of us on the planet. You can be of service in a great deal of ways to a lot of people by getting complete and living your life fully. From Diane, my husband passed away April 12, 2011. In many ways, the second year is harder than the first, mostly because it has really sunk in that he is not coming back. The fog has lifted and reality has settled in. Does it start getting easier in the third year? Well, I don't want to say I've got good news and I've got bad news, Diane, but I do want to suggest that over the many years I've been doing this, I have talked to more than 50,000 grieving people, the vast majority of whom were widows or widowers who had been in long-term marriages. And they report very much, by the time they would call us at the Grief Recovery Institute, it might have been a year or even two since their spouse had died. And at some point I would say to them, I guess you realize by now they lied to us that time doesn't heal your broken heart. And Diane, do you know what the vast majority of them said to us? They said, yeah, and it seems like it's getting worse. Your reaction is very typical of what happens to people out there. And what it boils down to, Diane, is because time doesn't heal, it gets worse, it can't get better. It's like a flat tire. I mentioned a flat tire won't get better by itself. Well, your heart won't either. It takes action. Now, in addition to the Grief Recovery Handbook, I want you and everyone else to know that throughout the United States of America, throughout Canada, various other countries where we have been doing programs for years, there are grief recovery specialists whose lives are devoted to helping grievers either in group sessions, in a program that John and I have developed over the last 30 years, or one-on-one for people who are unwilling or unable to be in group. And these grief recovery specialists can help take you through the actions that will help you within time to be able to deal with the emotional pain so that we don't wind up only with pain. We talked earlier in the opening about shedding the pain and having fond memories. I want to say I guarantee, I can almost 100% guarantee, if you're willing and do the work and get the help of one of our specialists to guide you, then you will be able to have that thing get easier. With that fog lifted and the pain has come in, it can go away now, and the fond memories, and you can rebuild your life. As you know, a couple of the other questions have been about rebuilding. I believe yours is too underneath. But you can't rebuild until you do the work. So, Diane, go to our website. There's a specialist finder there. There's also on tributes.com the specialist finder, and you can see if there's someone in your community that is helping grievers using our program. And I think you really, really benefit from it. How do I move on with two young kids who still ask for daddy? My husband died on our son's first birthday, and my daughter was 3.5 at the time, from Judy. Judy, my heart goes out to you as bigger than anyone. I mean, we're not going to compare losses, but what a burden on a burden on a burden. I mean, it's just unending. And I just imagine that how difficult it is, especially with the little one, who knew her daddy, and he's not there anymore. And one of the problems with young children is they don't understand the permanence of death. They can mimic the words, they can say, my daddy died, but they don't really know what it means yet. So it's really crucial, Judy, that you acquire skills to deal with your own incompleteness. When I don't mean incompleteness is bad, it means there's automatically unfinished business when your husband died young, leaving you with young children. There's unfinished dreams and hopes about all the future. But you have to deal with your feelings, because essentially you're the only tour guide that your children have. They are going to look to you for guidance. So what you do will determine what they do. It will, and if you can effectively learn how to be emotionally available to your own feelings and communicate them in a proper way to help guide your children in dealing with their feelings, as they become more and more aware of what the reality really means, the better you will help them. And now, I also want to recommend to you and everyone else in the situation, whether they're a parent or a grandparent, where there are young children in grief. Our second book is called When Children Grieve, and the subtitle is For Adults to Help Children Deal with Death, Divorce, Pet Loss, Moving, and Other Losses. There's an awful lot of things about how you can talk to your little ones, whose language skills and awareness is a little different than older children. But again, Judy, you're the key. What you do will dictate what happens with them. And one warning, and the book, we're very careful. The last thing we don't want your children over time to become your caretaker or your therapist. When children get turned into caretakers, it robs them of their childhood. And let's face it, your kids are already robbed of having their daddy. So we've got to make sure there's nothing else taken away from them in terms of creating as healthy and normal a life for them. And you're the key. What you do with your grief will help guide where they go. Please get our books. Go to the library if you can't afford them. Go to the library, go to the bookstore. Make sure you get them and start working on yourself now. You are the biggest cue or clue what will happen to them. And thanks, Judy. From Carol with an E, my husband of 25 years passed away on 12/26/12, and I realize automatically that means the day after Christmas. It seems I am getting more depressed as time goes by. Lots of crying. Now I feel guilty about so many things. E.g., if I don't read his horoscope daily, if I want to donate his art supplies or start cleaning up his art supplies, I even feel I should go to the cemetery every day. Is this part of the grieving process? I feel like I'm moving backwards. Well, Carol, as if you've been listening as we've been going here, one or two questions ago had something similar about feeling worse rather than better. And so that part of the answer is the same for you. And let me expand on that a little bit. In the immediate aftermath of the death of someone meaningful for you, and by the way, your loss, your husband's death is very recent. That's just 4 months ago. It's still raw. And so your reaction is still in a very raw state. And so a lot of crying is still pretty normal. I'm not overly concerned about that. Even your concerns about the things you might do with the stuff, it's still new. But what I know is that in the beginning, for most grievers, there's a sense of numbness for a while. And that numbness, in a way, can be helpful, because if you felt everything that it felt like, it would be intolerable. So it's almost like there's an emotional Novocaine that protects your emotional heart from feeling everything you would feel, because it's so incredibly painful. So what happens, though, as you come out of the inordinate numbness and non-feeling, a lot of feeling is coming in, the feeling that you couldn't have tolerated if you'd had it otherwise. So I want you to understand that you're not going backwards. You're moving towards something very natural, which is really feeling just how bad it feels, how empty it feels, how lost it feels, and any other words you might want to put about it. Now, one word I want to take away from you, and this is a big trap word, and the word is guilty that you use. Guilt, when you look in the dictionary, implies intent to harm. And Carol, I have no sense from your note, even though it's relatively short, that you ever did anything ever with intent to harm your husband, and certainly not in the things you've been thinking about and feeling about now. And if you use the wrong word, you'll create the wrong feelings. Now, I imagine you're very sad about things, you're very confused about things, you're lost about things, you don't know what you should do about things, but guilt with intent to harm isn't part of it. So let's change your language, if you're willing. Now, and before you make final decisions on donating supplies or doing that kind of stuff, I'm going to recommend you do the grief recovery work first, because that doing that, dealing with your emotions about his absence, your life without him, the things that will or won't happen without him coming up, when you do the emotional work first, Carol, you'll be able to make clearer decisions about stuff. And I don't want you giving away or donating stuff that you might not really want to part with, other than you'll have to go buy it back. We've seen widows and widowers go down and rebuy stuff from the store because someone, they or someone else put it, thought they should kind of have a new start. But you get to be the choice of that later. Now, you can go to the cemetery every day. That's perfectly okay. It can be excessive, if you're going for wrong reasons. Going to the cemetery doesn't substitute for doing grief recovery work. It is the doing of the work that will help you feel more complete and able to move forwards rather than backwards. Now, going to the cemetery is a personal choice. It's absolutely fine to do that, but it works best to make sure you're doing grief recovery work along the way. And thanks, Carol. From David, what are your suggestions for emotionally and mentally working with the following conditions? In addition to the challenges of a deep sense of loss of my life mate, I am sometimes reminded of various situations that provoke sharp regrets. Those feelings are sharpened by the realization that it is too late to correct the situation. I also wonder what thoughts my words or actions, or lack of, provoked in my wife's mind. Were they deep hurts or just a simple disappointment? David, this is an incredible combination of ideas and fabulous, because you have summed up in your questions or your statements something that I think affects nearly every griever, death of a spouse for sure, other deaths as well, even and divorces. And let me put some grief recovery language on this. When someone important to us dies, we always discover things we wish had happened differently, better, or more. And that is things we wish we'd said or not said, things we wish we'd done or not done, things we wish the other person had said or done or not said or done. Everybody. And it doesn't matter if it was the greatest relationship in the world or a moderate one or not such a good one. We all find things after people die that we wish had been different, better, or more. Pure. Now, there's another three words in addition to different, better, and more, and that is there are always unrealized hopes, dreams, and expectations about the future. And none of us is free of those either. They're a natural thinking, feeling, mental, emotional byproduct of the end of a relationship, where our brain says, what about those plans we have? Now, if you said to me, well, I was 91 and she was 90, I would still say you may have hopes, dreams, and expectations about the future. And one of the things is people say, well, you had her so long, you shouldn't feel bad. You were together for 70 years in that kind of length of relationship. But I can tell you without fear of contradiction that every person of that age I've ever talked to, and that's thousands of people, they all want more. You never get enough of someone you love. Now, as to your question about can you communicate, I'm going to kind of read in, can you communicate in a way to get complete with the things that did or didn't happen? In other words, your question, is it too late to correct? Correction is probably not the word. We can complete our relationship to the things we did or didn't do or didn't say, and that's really what the process of grief recovery is about. Because let's face it, the original idea for grief recovery was helping people who were dealing with the death. We've later modified it so we can deal with all losses. And if someone has died, you can't really fix what already happened, but you can complete it. You can apologize if there are things you discover that might have hurt her feelings. Without even knowing for sure, you can still, in an indirect way, not weird or strange, you can apologize for things that you did or didn't do that may have hurt her. You can also forgive her for things that she may have done that hurt you or not done. So there is a way of communicating those things in a completion without doing anything odd or strange that will help you feel more emotionally complete in relationship to your relationship with your wife so that you can move forward and not keeping punching yourself in the nose for things you did or didn't do. And thanks, David. Just a great set of ideas in there. Thanks for sending it in. Now, we happen to know that Georg is in Germany. I have a friend, and yesterday when I saw this question, I called my friend who speaks German because I wanted to honor Georg, which I think is the correct pronunciation of the word George in German. So I hope I've got that right, Georg. First of all, thank you very much for the chance to listen into your webinar, even 5,600 miles away in Emden, Germany. By a sad circumstance, I finally ended up at your very excellent website. Since there are some beloved ones and friends I've lost in the recent past, I think it will help me to understand how to handle my feelings in this matter. My question, why is grief sometimes not coming up directly, but arouses in unpredicted and pushes one off the balance? And I realize, Georg, you know, in English, I think we all get a sense of what he means, how it comes up from nowhere, we're not expecting us, the grief, and it pushes us off balance. It's a great question. There are, Georg, untold amount of stimuluses, or stimuli would be proper, that remind us of the person who has died. Obviously smells. When you're in the home that you lived in together, there are smells, there's clothing, there's things that you see, there are pictures, there are memories everywhere. When you get in your car and drive down the street, you'll go past restaurants you went to together, the church you went to. Every place, everything is a possible stimulus to remind you of her and of the relationship you had with her. So they are not as unpredictable as they may seem. They're actually very predictable. And they push you off balance because as you're adapting to life without her and trying to move forward day by day, they seem to come from nowhere. And this idea, perhaps, that you are in balance, which may or may not be an accurate idea, may get the best of you, and you may start crying, you may start thinking about it, may take you out of the moment. One of the things we want to make sure, if you're in the car when you have a moment like that, pull over to the side, because we don't think it's a good idea to drive a car while you're crying. You know, it's kind of an intelligent idea there. But please understand, the reactions you're having, though unpredicted, and putting you off balance are normal, natural, healthy, and they're not even bad. Every one of those things that comes up is a reminder of something that you may use when you do the grief recovery work to help you get complete with things that you loved or didn't like. And also, Georg, I want to tell you, if you contact us by email, we actually have the Grief Recovery Handbook in German, and I, as a special gift to you, be glad to send you one all the way to Germany. If you just kind of let us know, send in a thing through Tributes, and I will send, and John and I will sign the book for you. And we thank you. But Dankeschön, Georg. From Jane. My question is, how do you help someone who has lost their spouse to get through the longing and the painful anguish of missing that person? Obviously, they will miss their spouse always. Jane, I'm really glad that we make a little shift now to the people around the grieving spouses, because this is not equally important, it's differently important, and I hope I can shed some light on this. Firstly, I'm going to say, though, is slightly awkward, so let me say this as gently as I can. We can't always help someone else, but especially we can't do that if they haven't asked. We have to be very careful about putting ourselves on them in a way about wanting to help them. Some people will really resist that. Now, if the person has asked for help or made it clear either verbally or non-verbally they're looking for input, then boy, oh boy, we really want to do that. It's getting through the longing, though, is not the idea we'd be after. What we want to help them do is get as emotionally complete as they can, again, with the things they wish had happened differently, better, and more, and the unrealized hope, dreams, and expectations about the future. That will help them get out of that loop. We've seen a lot of people that stay in that longing or yearning loop, and in the early days of grief, it's fairly natural, but after a while, it becomes a habit. It's where people develop a relationship or identity with their pain. And the guidance we're going to give you, Jane, and for everyone else listening, is the first thing we want you to do is go to the library or bookstore and get a copy of the Grief Recovery Handbook. We want you to read the first 58 pages, which is part one. And in those pages, you will find some really helpful stuff, including a debunking of those myths I was talking about earlier. It's really crucial because if you try to help someone and you say the wrong things, they will kind of pull away from you. That's really a tricky situation. And the real deal is you read the 58 pages and then you go to that person, if you live near them, and you say, I want to loan you this book or give you this book. I've been reading it and found it tremendously helpful for me. Now, Jane, see what I'm doing there is I'm making it about you. One of the possible dangers when we try to help others is say, here's a book you need. A lot of people, because they've been socialized to be strong and they're trying not to feel bad, even though that's not an accurate thing, they will sometimes recoil because it sounds like you're saying they need therapy or whatever. Now, again, if they've asked for help, then dismiss everything I've said and help them. But the best way to help them is to get them involved with better information to learn the actions of grief recovery. The truth is you can't make their feelings go away, and trying to isn't even a good idea. Missing the other person is not necessarily bad for them, and I agree with that. They'll always be aware the other person is gone, but it doesn't have to be missing eventually in a painful way. Missing someone can have, my mom died 19 years ago, and of course I miss her to whatever degree, but I have absolute access to talking about her, laughing, even crying once in a while, having feelings about her, and having her still be a part of my life even though she has gone. So we want to turn from missing to reincorporating them in your life in a different way without their physical presence. And thanks again, Jane. From Anonymous. How do you reconcile the feelings of guilt over what you could have done to have supported and encouraged your spouse more in health issues, which could have prolonged life? Oh, Anonymous, boy, oh boy, let's go with the guilt question again. I want to repeat this because it's a big one. Guilt implies intent to harm, and I have no sense from your question that you ever did that. We also all tend to be Monday morning quarterbacks. And if you don't know the expression, it means after the game is over, we look back and say, oh, I could have done this, I should have done that. If I'd only done this, and I could have done that. Well, that tends to happen when a death has happened too. When we go back over, our brain will automatically say, oh gosh, if only we got to the doctor earlier, if only I could have convinced her to quit drinking or quit smoking or do more exercise or whatever. So I want you to get the word guilt out of there, and I want you to do some grief recovery work where you'll review the whole relationship, not just the things that happen at the end. I don't want you to hold your feet to the fire, because sometimes the reality, and most of the time, is we did not have the power to really have altered things. And in the end, I often think, and this is not anything other than a suggestion, and may or may not be true for you, that your ultimate question is really your broken heart talking, that you miss that person so much that it's trying to find a blame. And I don't want to blame you. I want you to have be focused on what the relationship was and not focused on the ending. So please give that a try. And as we're waiting for the next question to come up, I want to just stop a moment and talk about our grief recovery specialists throughout America, many of whom are listening tonight, who are the lifeline for this organization that has been going for 37 years with the motto of helping the largest amount of grieving people and the largest number of people in the shortest amount of time. And I want to tip my hat and John's hat to these people who work tirelessly. If you call, if any of you listening call or contact any of our grief recovery specialists in your community, you'll find them having a heart of gold. You'll find them listening to you different than anyone else. And you'll, interestingly, because they know more about the myths than almost anybody, you won't find them saying things that offend you. They will listen to you and not tell you silly things like don't feel bad when it's logical to feel bad. And so, and don't forget, you can find this, our specialist at the Specialist Finder site on the Grief Recovery Institute website and at tributes.com. So one of the things John and I, and let me just stay on this for one more moment. John and I want to make sure when he and I go to a party individually, someone finds out what we do. We help grieving people. And they inevitably say, where were you when I needed you 20 years ago when my child died or 10 years ago when my spouse died? And the thing John and I never want again is for someone not to be able to find help when they want it or need it. That's our mission as well as our other statements. So make sure you look, if you or someone you know is hurting, find one of the specialists in your community because help is there if you know to ask for it. Now, from Diana, if your spouse died from a long-term illness, is it normal to feel okay with their passing knowing what that is what they wanted? And let's answer these sections of Diana's one at a time. I think what you're referring to, Diana, is the what we call the conflicting feelings caused by a change or an end in a familiar pattern of behavior. And the classic explanation of that is that if someone you love is dying of a long-term illness, and over a long period of time you watch them go through a cancer or some other dread disease, so much so that it is agonizing to watch it, and you know they're in mortal agony, and they are. And when they die, you are liable to have a feeling of relief, which is more of a positive sounding word, that they are no longer here. You're liable to have a feeling of relief that they are no longer in pain, which is a good feeling. It is absolutely a healthy one. When you've seen that there's no help is possible, there's no miracle possible, so relief is a feeling. At the other hand, you're devastated that a miracle didn't happen. You're devastated that they're gone and that it's final. So those conflicting feelings are grief. So it's normal to feel okay or relieved when they die. That is normal. It's healthy. There's nothing wrong with it. As long as we also remember that you have the other side of things, that you're devastated that they're no longer here, that you miss them. So it's a very dual set of feelings. The next part of Diana's question, is it normal that others seem to be more emotional than you are about their passing, making you wonder if something is wrong with you when you seem stronger than they are? This is a great question. This is the issue of comparing our insides to other people's outsides or our outsides to other people's insides, and it brings up the crucial issue in grief that we, and I hopefully have avoided this absolutely on this session. We never ever compare grievers. We never compare loss. We never compare anything. Comparison tends to minimize feelings in whichever direction you go. So we don't recommend that anyone compare ever. Now, so I don't want you, Diana, to compare. You are exactly who you are with whatever your background, your makeup, your emotional self, your communication self. Nobody gets to be you. Stronger isn't necessarily virtuous. Stronger just means often hiding feelings. All I want from you, Diana, which I think you're something you have just based on your, you just be truthful. Tell the truth about yourself in the moment that you're having a feeling, whether you're happy or sad or whatever, that's exactly what you need to do. Just be honest. And the third part is, can you trust that you will be with them again in the next life, as so many people tell you that you will be? Well, you know, a lot of people kind of can come off sounding like they're experts in afterlife, and all kinds of things. When we get that question, we always refer people outwards to clergy or some other spiritual people. Obviously, we may have some opinions based on all the years we're doing this, but my opinion, if it's different than yours, can cause a conflict between you and me, and all I ever want to do is help you deal with the reality that here you are in this life, trying to walk and talk and breathe without that person who was here. So we want to, you know, lovingly defer that question. Go to the people who specialize in more spiritual or religious things for that answer, or look inwards. The real issue for us is the quality of your life between now and when you die. That's what we're really into, Diana, and thanks so much. Okay, I think this may be our last question for this session, and then we'll get ready to close down. From Kim, we lost my mother this past October unexpectedly. My parents were married for 63 years. I have a doctorate in nursing practice with a specialty in end-of-life care, but I can't seem to help my father's heart smile again. Oh, Kim, what incredible language. Do you have any suggestions? My father is a very religious, spiritual man, yet he seems so lost every day. How can I help him enjoy life again? Thanks for any help you can give. And thank you, Kim. I mean, I expect there are an awful lot of people who, like you, have a massive concern for one of their parents who has survived the other one and is having a real struggle. So this happens a lot. It's not a new phenomenon. Like I answered something, it's a little hard for you to do for someone else. My recommendation, reading your note as clearly and carefully as I can, is for you to spend as much time with your dad as you can when you're with him, in terms of engaging conversations about his relationship with mom, okay? Where you can say, gosh, Dad, I remember the time you and mom and I went here, my brother, whatever your family structure, remember some things. Not all good things, good, bad, awkward, stubborn. Remember mom, the person, as you knew her in your relationship with her, to trigger his relationship with mom, the person who was his spouse for all those years, to engage his heart, because laughing and crying and remembering and it accurately will help him revitalize the relationship. The thing you need to know and in some way get across to him is this. His physical relationship with your mom ended when she died. He still has an emotional and spiritual one. Let's activate it. And the spiritual has an aspect of religious. Let's activate it by you talking about mom, bringing him out, and helping him remember her and all things. And I think you and he could have something that would really make his heart smile again. And thank you, Kim. Now, I am going to tell you that there are two major websites we really want to encourage you to visit, www.tributes.com, which we are so proud to be associated with, and ours, www.griefrecoverymethod.com. Please visit them. Enjoy the values that they have. It won't cost you anything, but you'll get something of tremendous value. Now, Now, we actually have four books. The very first is a book called The Grief Recovery Handbook, and it is now in a 20th anniversary expanded edition. And not only does it deal with death and divorce, it deals with loss of faith, loss of health, loss of career, and all other losses. When Children Grieve, I mentioned earlier, for adults to help children. Our third book is focused entirely on divorces and other romantic endings. We have a fourth book that's not on the slide called Moving Beyond Loss that was written as a result of the questions and answers we got on tributes.com. All of them are available at our website and at Amazon.com. And finding help. Now, I've mentioned a few times in this hour finding help for a personal loss. If you or someone else is suffering from a loss, we can help. We have thousands of certified grief recovery specialists to assist you. Find one. That's what you'll find both on our website and on Tribute's website. Go there, put in your zip code, and you can find someone near you. And now, I want to turn this back over to Elaine to close down the proceedings with a thank you to all of you for your time and your hearts and your questions.
Thank you so much, Russell. Thank you, everyone, for attending. For anyone that might have joined late or would like to see the presentation again, we have been recording it, and it will be available on tributes.com in the Grief Recovery Center under the Webinar tab. And we should have it up and running sometime tomorrow, and then it will be available from then on, as Russell mentioned, the other webinars he had done previously. So there'll be three of them there tomorrow, and including this evening. So again, thank you all so much. I hope you found it as helpful and hopefully inspiring in a way to address your feelings. And at tributes.com, we're always, again, so grateful to have Russell and have him working with all the people who come to our site and are obviously navigating grief if they're there. So thank you again, Russell, and good evening, everyone.